healthy rotator cuffs in your yoga practice means that you will be able to mobilize your shoulders in back bends, handstands, and stay free of pain on the mat, but outside the mat as well. In this video, I will be going through the four muscles that make the rotator cuff. In a beautiful animation, I will show you where they sit, as well as how they contract depending on the shoulder movement. I will speak about the importance of scapula in relation to rotator cuffs. And finally, I will give you two exercises that if you use them, you can stay free of any rotator cuff problems in two poses that often cause rotator cuff injuries: the downward dog and the chaturanga. The first muscle is subspinatus, which facilitates shoulder abduction. It is worth remembering that at the end range of the movement, shoulder abduction comes hand in hand with external rotation. The second muscle is infraspinatus, which facilitates two movements: external rotation as well as transverse abduction. The third one is teres minor, which again facilitates external rotation. And finally, subscapularis, which facilitates internal rotation. You may have noticed that three out of the four muscles are associated with external rotation and only one with internal rotation. The reason why it's important to know which muscles facilitate which movements is so that we can keep our practice structured and safe in the beginning. If, for example, we know that at the end of shoulder flexion, we have to externally rotate as well, and that three specific rotator cuff muscles facilitate external rotation, we can strengthen them and thus help this particular movement. The position of the scapula is very important when it comes to rotator cuff function. All four of the rotator cuffs have an insertion point in the scapula. In a 2013 study, they found that 68% of rotator cuff problems coexisted with scapula instability. So the two are almost synonymous. The intended scapula position in any pose should be the opposite of what gravity would promote if the muscles were relaxed, which means that in downward dog or a handstand, the shoulder blade should be elevated, in chaturanga, protracted. You can check a video where I'm reviewing all the movements of scapula and shoulders to get a visual cue of what it means: protracted, retracted, elevated and depressed shoulder blades. As promised, I would like to give you two exercises for strengthening your scapula, one related to chaturanga, one related to downward facing dog. For the one in chaturanga, I would like you to have a resistance band and place it around your wrists. Keep your elbows slightly in front of your rib cage, and the palms should be as wide as your shoulders. From here, while maintaining the elbows in, I would like you to push the band out with your wrists without lifting your shoulders. So you want to avoid that and instead push the wrist out. One extra thing I would like you to keep in mind is that for some of us, this movement of the spine may be promoted, which we want to fight by contracting our glutes and maintaining the navel in. So this is how it would look from the side, and that's how it would look from the front. For downward facing dog, I would like you to first flex your shoulders, try to lift them so much so that if possible the shoulders are touching your ears, and from there, with the palms facing towards each other or even a little bit towards your back, push the wrists out. And try not to lose the flexion of the shoulders, and try not to allow the shoulders to come down as you push the wrists out. Doing these two exercises for 3 sets, 8 to 10 reps a day, will do wonders for stabilizing your rotator cuffs in these two postures. Of course, these are only two exercises, and there is a plethora of other exercises you can perform either with weights or with bands. I would like to know what is your experience with shoulders, rotator cuffs in your yoga practice. So leave me in the comments your experience, if you faced any injuries and what you did in order to overcome them. 1 year before I started practicing yoga, I had a shoulder injury. There was black ice on the road and I came off my motorbike. I found yoga being very beneficial, but especially what helped me the most was my handstand practice. I think it is worth telling you this because there is this misconception that handstands overtax the shoulders. But the reality is that if they are practiced properly, they will, if anything, strengthen, stabilize the shoulders, and in my case, they even helped me recover from the injury. So looking forward to reading your comments with your experience in terms of rotator cuff and shoulder health in your yoga practice, as I would be curious to know what my subscribers have experienced with this tricky area of the body.